Oh, ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the podcast. It's a very special podcast tonight. We've got a special guest here. Please welcome your favorite and mine, number 21, Mr. Ryan Gavigan, to the podcast here, ladies and gentlemen. Ryan, what are you wearing?
This is a Lagunitas sweatshirt that I purchased that I was very intoxicated. It looks like you're actually wearing a similar one.
I feel like it's the same thing.
My favorite part about it is I did not realize the back.
That it said Longa Fucanitas on the
of
back.
This
yep.
sweatshirt had so much cussing on it. And Sam, of course, read it as she was washing it. And she was like, "Is this yours? It's really inappropriate." And I was like, "Yes, it is." And I've worn it to drop my kids off at school.
Yeah.
It's one of my favorite sweatshirts. So
I actually think the best part about this sweatshirt is that when we got it, we did not realize the profanity was on there. And I think I wore it like 3 or 4 times in public first. Yeah. But we were just like, "Oh, it's so soft. It's so great.
Yeah.
This
I've
is
never
a great
looked
brewery."
At the back of the shirt. And I spilled on it like immediately today, which is going to rock it.
So there are obviously a couple of big things that happened this week. Last week sucked for injuries. So we should talk about that too. Implications from the injuries, what that does for teams moving forward. There was how many teams were on bye last week? Was it just two?
It felt like more. Bye week's just starting up. It's always like a shock to the system.
Yeah.
You think your team's good, and then you're like, "Oh, I can't play my running back one, and the other guy's hurt," and all of a sudden you're starting, you know, someone's backup.
Pretty much. And I think this is around the time where waivers get really dicey because you're really just buying a rental. But I think everybody has to, like, if you are in the waiver market, everybody just tends to overspend. You have to, like, if you need a position, like, you can't really risk it. It's like the guy that's on waiver or literally nobody if you don't have the depth for it on your bench.
Yeah. And there was a few waivers earlier this year. Like, I think it was like week one or two when those two guys from the Rams came out, you know, Puka Nacua and
right,
Kyren Williams, where it's like we were kind of just feeling out this whole fab thing. Nobody really knew how people were going to bet. I think I was like second or third for both of those guys. And now I'm just like kicking myself for being a coward and not betting more, because like I don't know what I'm going to do with this fab money at the end of the year. I don't think I get paid that out, do
I? You can't take it with you. I know. And that's tough. That's a tough pill to swallow, but you cannot take it with you. By the way, congratulations, though, this week. You were the $25 winner for most points.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Probably the only time this year. It made Monday Night Football exciting to watch.
Yep.
Couple of close games.
There was at least three.
Week, so
there was yours, there was mine, and then
let's be clear, my actual game wasn't close. It was actually a bloodbath. But between me and Peel competing for top score,
right,
Pollard got that like big long. I thought I lost already after Pollard's long pass play, but somehow squeaked it out. Pollard, I don't know if he scored a point in the fourth quarter, so that really helped.
No, he did not. And what was your margin of victory for top points? Do you remember the differential?
I think it was less than a point.
Yeah.
It was pretty close.
That's how unbelievably close some of this stuff was. So there was that. There was mixed matchup with Sean that I thought actually came. That was a heartbreak.
That was heartbreak. Sean. I don't know how that happens. Sean, I'm sorry, man, if you're listening to this. I mean, Mix, he's done it to me. He's done it to a few people. Unfortunately, he forfeited the rest of the season, but you know, I think his first 6 weeks really incredible, really, really cool story. But that's too bad.
We're certainly going to talk about Mick on this podcast. I feel like he's going to be quite the subject, as I feel like I'll also be in the spotlight, but I'm going to give you the floor for most of that because I'm not sure that I'm free to comment on myself at this point.
So I'm still crunching the numbers, analyzing some data over here. I did zero prep work, so I'm happy to do some, you know, some number crunching on the air. We can really just kind of dig into some stats.
We will. I have all play stuff, which is going to be really interesting when we get into that. And then we'll do matchups too. But let's kind of start with the injuries. So I'm just going to run down this list and just read off some names to you, and let's just get your facial reactions. I think that's going to be the best way. We'll start with the biggest hurt for me is Justin Fields.
Yeah. I don't care. That's fine. You know, the Bears are the Bears.
Yeah.
Kind of excited to see this other guy.
Sure.
He can at least like look at more than one receiver. So interested to see what he does. Not excited for like battle of the backups here with the Raiders. It's going to be a really ugly football game, but
yeah. Oh, by the way, so let me ask you something. You did zero prep work, so this is a perfect question. How many teams scored more than 21 points in week six? There was only two. There was only two teams on bye, I believe.
More than how many points?
21.
Yeah, super low scoring from a fantasy perspective. So I won the week with like 130 something. So I don't know, maybe like three, four.
Five teams, close. Five teams scored more than 21 points. And actually, it might be 21 points or more. I forget what the statistic was that I heard.
Well, if you lied to me, I'm going to be upset.
Okay, well, that makes sense. Trevor Lawrence is another name. So Tannehill, Garoppolo, Baker Mayfield, all quarterback names that got hurt this past week.
Yeah, and the quarterback, I mean, like five, I think it's like five big injuries to quarterbacks, which is just brutal. Such a critical position. The problem is it doesn't just impact that player. It impacts everyone around them, you know?
Right.
So you don't know what to do with the receivers on the team. Sometimes it even makes them one dimensional. So their running game gets impacted. It's just never fun to see a backup quarterback come in there from a fantasy perspective.
Yep. And then you got CMC, Montgomery, Kyron Williams, Ronnie Rivers, Tyreek Hill somehow did manage to make it onto the injury report. Garrett Wilson, DK Metcalf, Debo Samuel left the game early. The rest of these names probably aren't worth throwing down, like LaVisca Chenault. Okay, we're good. But those are all legit starting fantasy players. You know, maybe not all the quarterbacks in a 10-person league, but like I think every running back I named outside of Ronnie Rivers, who a lot of people were speculatively like adding him. Because of the Rams situation, like,
yeah, I mean, it makes it so you just can't really touch anyone on the Rams running back field. I mean, who knows what Sean McVay is going to do? Cam Akers may just come back and play a couple snaps. Who knows what he's up to these days, but,
Let's hit that coach talk today thing that I posted in GroupMe. Like I legit noticed that, like, you know, later today, how unbelievably frustrating is that of like not, if you're the player, I'm not talking about from like fantasy perspective, but like if the coach is saying to the media, like, I don't know, it could be anybody. And you're like, dude, I'm prepping to be your dude. Like, could you just back me up here? Like,
there's a reason he's the third string running back, Andrew. I mean, I think it's a fair comment by the coach. Like, I have no idea. It could be a fan. Like, we might hold a competition in the parking lot before the game. We have no idea.
I would actually pay pretty decent money to see that like take place. Didn't somebody win the Pat McAfee kicking challenge this week too?
I don't know. He
had the field goal challenge that no one's won, and I think somebody kicked the 50 yarder or something like that and actually won $10,000 from him. So but I mean there were just a shitload of injuries this week. And that was something I just thought, like, you know, that's gonna be impactful. I actually, in all that, in all seriousness, like I really do feel bad for Peel because he traded for Richardson, who went on season ending IR. Or is about to. I mean, there's no way he plays the rest of the year. And then his backup was Fields, who he had benched to take Richardson. And then this happens to Fields. So now he's got to bench Fields and he's playing Jordan Love.
Yeah. So like, I mean, Jordan Love's still serviceable. Like, that's the thing. Quarterbacks. The problem is we're getting, he's serviceable from a fantasy perspective. I think the Packers are a terrible organization. And I hope Jordan Love continues to get worse every week, like he has throughout the season.
We're so spiteful. That's all we have.
I heard he's a nice person.
I'm sure.
Unlike somewhere. His predecessor, who was a D-bag all around. I know, you know, the Jets tried to revitalize him.
I mean, that one I think hurts for Peel. The CMC thing is interesting to me because the reports initially were like, it could have been season ending. And then I guess it's not nearly as serious at all. Honestly, I haven't heard anything outside of like just an oblique injury. They haven't really said what it is that's going on.
Last I heard is like an MRI on Monday.
And then nothing, right?
Last I checked, like it's Wednesday.
Yeah.
kind of weird that we're not getting an update. I guess we're kind of spoiled with, you know, Twitter and like how plugged in we are with some of these players. But I mean, the guy's a stallion. If he can play, he'll get back out there and he'll dominate. Does make me wonder if they'll like maybe do a little bit more like workload management with him, and kind of mix in Elijah Mitchell a little bit more. Because CMC, I mean, I feel like got 100% of the snaps for the first 6 weeks.
Yeah.
Until he got hurt.
But if you're any coach in the NFL and you have a CMC level talent, why would you hamper that play like at all? Why wouldn't you just be like, dude, just ride this like as long as you can?
It's really weird. I mean, the NBA, you're seeing like more load management there. Like you have guys taking off regularly. So a team like the 49ers, like they're going to make the playoffs. Right. So like, I mean, you could theoretically bench him a couple times, or like
yeah.
you go up by three touchdowns and you pull him out. I mean, it's not unheard of, but I think they just don't care about longevity for these players is the unfortunate part. So they'll just like ride him into the ground.
Yeah. And
a lot of running backs.
Running back too, especially. Yeah. I mean, I actually think it's a much better idea. Like if your record supports you, I think it's always a fight for like the number one seed for these teams, which does go pretty late into the season. But like outside of that, if you got an unlock, these guys better not touch the field. Like I'm so tired of seeing the preseason games where Baltimore would put in and lose a running back for the year. It's like happened the past 5 years.
Yeah. I mean, and they just have no one that's inspiring afterwards. Like,
right.
You know, you can see with the Dolphins and stuff, they got A-Chain or A-Chain, whatever he's going by now.
Yeah.
Like they have some depth, right? But some of these teams, they just have no running back depth.
Well, they have Wilson Jr. coming back too.
Yeah.
And
he'll be injured in 2 weeks too. I mean,
yeah, but like, so will Mostert too, if we're going off that logic, like that guy is always injured, but he's looked fantastic this year.
Yeah, he looks fast. He's looked great on the Niners too. It's just a matter of like how many football games can he actually play in the year?
How many? I'm gonna give you the line here. If you know the answer, just say it right away, obviously. But like, how many touchdowns does Mostert have, over or under 10 and a half
this year?
Yeah, this year. Also, we're through 6 weeks, going on 7, and I'm using 10 and a half as the line.
Yeah, I mean, it's probably over. But, I mean, I know between him and Achan, they had like, didn't they both have like 3 or 4 in one, like one of the weeks?
The 70-point week. Yeah, they both had 4 touchdowns.
Yeah. So I feel like it's over. And now Achan's not even playing. So, I mean, Mostert's, I mean, he should be over 10 if he's not.
He's got 11 touchdowns this year.
Yeah.
That is insane. That is an insane amount of touchdowns.
How many touchdowns do the Bears have?
he might actually have more than the Bears do combined, honestly. He really might, which is just so sad to think about.
Yeah.
No, because Fields had a 4-touchdown game. And
I don't know.
Yeah, I mean
you can't count Fields and DJ Moore touchdowns. You can't combine those two touchdowns.
No, right. That's not 8. It's just 4. Yeah. I get it. I wish I could, because then football would be more interesting to watch, but it's just not. It's so bad. What do you want to do first? Do you want to go into the all play section? You want to go into the matchups? You want to go into the trades?
I mean, I have no idea what the all play section is. So you'll have to explain it to me.
Okay. let's just do that right now. So all play is a stat that if you played everybody every week, what would your record be? Right. Like it just basically says like, who is the best person in the league? Like, so
best person.
Well, the best record reflected by how good your team has performed. If you
like
played,
you might be high on those lists, but after that trade, you're a terrible person.
Okay. The trade section sounds like it's later. So let's get to that later. So if we're looking at all play, Peel has an amazing race, 42, and he'd be 42-12. He'd have a 77.8% win record this year. Hans Molman would be second at 36-18. Camperdude would be at third at 33-21. The Menace would be 28-26 with just over 51%. There's a pretty decent drop off into fourth place here, because like everybody else is going to be 50% and under. Nick is at fifth at 27. So he's flat at 50%. The Bandits are sixth, which is what I thought was the most interesting. You'd have a 23-31 record, 42.6.
A lot of heartbreak over here, but you don't get points for that. So,
well, and there's a luck metric to this too that I want to put together something to show, like, you know, how unlucky a manager has been. But like, I think when you fall under this threshold here too, like points you know, against her are going to come into factor, which we'll get to today too. And then Sean is at 7, Brett is at 8, Carlos is at 9, and then Zach is at 10. We haven't heard a lick from Zach all year, which I just think is a great 17 and 37.
He's still playoff one right now, 3-3. So
that's the amazing part, because if he played every team every week, he'd be 17 and 37. He'd have a 31.5% win rate. Yeah. So for him to be 3-3 is actually impressive.
Not how fantasy football works, though.
Nope. Right now, as of week 6, Peel is setting the league record for 829 points. Blood Brothers has just a really paltry 661 points in the season. Camper Dude, week 5, 197.26. This is the highest point total of the year. He also has the biggest margin. He won 197-90 against me. Was that against me? Who did he beat? Oh yeah. No. That was Brett. That was Brett. Going into that weekend, we were all just like getting blown out too. So at least we didn't really have to like care that much.
Yeah. I had a chance to come back and then still like, I think still lost, in like heartbreaking fashion, but
yeah, fun. No, I know. Well, we'll get to the Monday too. Don't let me forget about that, because Monday was pretty electric for last minute storylines. And I think it changed the narrative of the season. No Gritty's on a 4-game win streak right now, which is good. Like we talked about, Blood Brothers being 3-3, winning 50% of their matchups, but only has that 31.5% all play thing is incredibly lucky. And then not so lucky are the Bandits.
Yeah.
Who have a 42.6% win rate in the all play standings, but has gone 2-4 this season. So you should be 3-3 essentially, according to this, somewhere in that wheelhouse. And then the sharpshooter Pontiac Bandits is a fantasy savant in the making, with a league leading start sit accuracy score of 87.8% this season. In second place on that is Hans Molman with 86.9%, which just means that you and you, whoever's on your bench, you're outscoring them because they're in your active roster. So you're picking the right people to play.
That's because everyone on my bench is injured.
That's correct.
Every week. So it's been very easy to select a starting lineup. You can look at my team this week. I only have 3 players on my bench that could score points.
Yeah.
And one of them is actually not going to play. So
upcoming week. Yes, your previous week you had that same thing. I think everybody was either on bye or hurt.
Yeah, Roshan still is in concussion protocol, which doesn't look good for me.
He's not going to play, if that's the case. Tomorrow, if he's not full practice, he won't.
Yeah, I'm in trouble. So I might be starting both Pittsburgh running backs, which just basically means I'm forfeiting because they're both.
Well, Ryan, I don't know if you knew, I'm in the market to trade. So if you need somebody to fleece you, I'd be happy to do it.
Yeah, I don't, not in the mood to get trade raped, but
okay,
maybe a different day.
Okay, sure, fair. We just talk regular trades, son. Regular trades. What are you drinking over there? What you got?
This is a cold brew coffee. Oh, nitro. It's very nice.
Wonderful. Oh, you switched a tap, didn't you?
I have 2 taps, actually. Installed. Yeah.
Ooh, fancy.
Come over. Check it out.
I will. That's an open invite. I will be there. All right. What's next? Trades or previous week?
Let's go previous week. I mean, let's go in chronological order here.
Let's do previous week here. Let's go through the matchups. We'll go through some of the heartbreak that happened. Heartbreak number one for me, we'll go in order of 3-2-1. I feel like heartbreak number 3, like not as big of an impact as the other two, was your win over the most points for the week. That to me was one of the top 3 storylines of the week that progressed on Monday, because you won by what, less than a point?
Yeah. Looks like 0.7 points here.
Yeah.
So like 7 yards. It's tough. I mean, I thought I had lost it pretty early on. I think multiple teams had a chance to beat me. And I thought that game was gonna be a lot more high scoring on Monday.
Breaking news. We have No Gritty has added Wandale Robinson and dropped Kendrick Bourne, bringing his daily moves up to 12. Sorry.
It's pretty impressive. I also didn't realize that he has no waiver budget. I don't know who he's spent his money on.
KJ Osborne. $60-something on KJ Osborne.
Oh, okay, yeah. That's a lot.
He panicked after Justin Jefferson got injured.
Justin Jefferson's a good receiver. He's only probably behind one other receiver. So.
Yeah. No, I get why he did it, but it's tough to not leave a little budget for the rest of the year. So.
Not stopping him from making moves.
No, not at all. He's got 38 moves in the season right now. He's the benefactor of removing the cap. But anyway, sorry, you were saying by 7 yards.
Yeah. So do I put in the Cash App request or how does that work?
I sent it to you already, dude.
Done this in a long time. So
I'm very astute. The worst is when the Jeffs overtook me, I think, in week two by like a point or something like that. And I was like, you motherfuckers, and I'm the one that has to write your check. That's the worst part as commissioner is like writing the check for something that you were in the competition for. And you just like, oh, got to grit your teeth and send it. So,
yeah, I mean, it's just, I mean, it is a nice little like something to cheer about, you know, week to week. So it still makes week to week interesting.
Yeah. I like it better than the negative thing that we had, like, oh, you owe everybody something if you don't. And then that compounds like that. I don't know. That just ended up being a dumb rule in enforcing because it's like, what? I owe everybody 50 cents? That's stupid. And then it was like, well, yeah, you got to go put in Cash App things for nine other owners. So, like, don't bullshit their time and you won't have to do this bullshit to that, you know.
That is pretty insulting though. I mean, if you have to go in and you'd have to make it a different amount for every person and you got to Cash App this guy $1, this person $2. That way you have to do each transaction. It's real punishment.
Yeah, it was I think it was $5 for the first one person that missed like due to injury or like not switching, and then it doubled every time, so then it was 10, 20, 40 and capped at 60. But like you'd have to split $60 between nine people, so it always ended up being like, well, you can bring it back. Just throw it back up in the vote next year.
No, I do like the – I heard one where a league does, if you start someone who gets 0 points for the week, that you have to shotgun a beer on camera and send it to the team.
Even an active player.
Yeah, even an active player. So, like, if you start an active player, which the active player probably comes from injury, but you do have, like, some wide receivers who just put up 0 points.
Higgins goosed me week one. Yeah. Higgins absolutely goosed me week one.
So that, you know, we could throw some rules out like that. I don't know how to submit rule changes, but that's something that I should pay attention to so I can just submit absurd rules like that.
For the record, for everybody who listens, all 10,000 of you, all they have to do is submit an email request with the subject line asking for a rule change. They don't even have to do that. You just say like, hey, I'd like to make this rule change proposal. And then that gets sent to the league. You get one in-season rule change request per manager, per team. So you can make one rule change request for in-season changes.
For this season even?
Yeah, you can ask to have an impact this season. Yeah.
That's absurd.
Well, we haven't had it yet.
Who voted on that?
Nobody, because we never actually put this thing up, so nobody. So... all right. The number two storyline, I think, is mine. Nick had me pretty good going into this like Monday night matchup all the way up until I think it was Mike Evans and Gabe Davis did absolutely nothing in their matchups.
Yeah.
And it was like 8.9. And I got Knicks by Higgins and Ridley in my matchup too. So it's like, okay, well, it doesn't matter how well everybody else did. But as soon as that happened, it was like, it was down by 18. And I was like, okay, I got Keenan Allen on Monday night against Dallas. Like I could see this going either way. Either Dallas is going to shut him down or he's going to get right around that. And, he scored that quick touchdown in the first quarter and it was just, you know, put him at 10 points. And then I just like all eyes in the game from that point out, just like, just pass to him. And then when he hit, he was over by 0.02, and I was like, just bench him. You could just bench him now. He doesn't need to do anything. But knowing my luck, there would be like some sort of stat correction.
Yeah.
Well, there was.
Their whole offense is him and Eckler. I mean, they run their entire offense through those two guys.
That's it. Yeah. My biggest concern is everyone else's concern is like, health. He's always had an issue at some point, and he's what, 31 now? For him to look as good as he is looking at this, I mean, this is a career year for him in terms of stats, which is nutty.
Yeah, he looked great last year too when he came back from injury. So
that's true. Yeah.
The problem is they don't really have anyone behind him. I mean, Palmer's looking okay. Quinton, the guy whoever I just dropped, they're not throwing the ball. So he's a rookie. Like, maybe he'll be good at the end of the year after Keenan Allen gets hurt, but we'll see.
The rookie wide receivers usually come on like late at the end of their first year, and then like year two is where they either show up or don't.
Yeah.
Okay, and then obviously I think the number one heartbreaking matchup this week was the Mick and the Sean matchup here, where Sean had Eckler and let me just pull up the match. Hold on. He had two people.
Eckler and Herbert.
Yeah, he had Eckler and Herbert. And at the end of the game, Herbert could have thrown to Eckler, and that would have just done it.
There were multiple times where Eckler was open. He threw that ball late in the flat.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
Got stuffed on the 1 yard line. I also saw that Eckler was playing against himself in fantasy football. So there may have been some collusion going on there where like he didn't want to score because he doesn't have himself on his fantasy football team. And so I don't know about this, but this is one thing I read on Twitter, a very reliable source.
Yeah.
But he was playing against himself. So some people out there are saying that he might have been throwing that, you know, didn't want to get in the end zone.
I've never seen self-collusion before, but there's a first time for everything.
Yeah, something to think about. Everyone's out to get you. And everyone's just rooting for Mick except for you, so.
I'm rooting for Mick. I'm just flabbergasted at what this man has been able to put together on his team.
Yeah, I'm wondering when he's going to give you Kelsey, if that's going to be right before playoffs or...
You guys have to understand that this man is a savant. He made this move knowing something we all don't know. So, like, I will get fleeced on this deal. It's not going to be him. It's going to be me.
We can only hope.
But it does make me losing that much sweeter, I guess, right? For everybody else.
I just wish you did it after I played you and, like, before I played Mick. I don't know how many points Tyreek Hill scored against me, but I'm sure it was, like, 40.
Yeah. Oh, you have to play him. You have to play Tyreek.
Yeah, I'm going to play Tyreek Hill like three times this year.
Oh, that's gross. That's not fun. Yeah, so let's get into these trades. So we had that first, the big trade here, obviously, was the Breece Hall, Breece Lightning for Mostert and Pickens. What did you think of that trade?
I'm more excited about Breece Hall than Mostert. I think Breece Hall's looking really good lately. He's getting a lot of usage. The Jets can stay frisky if Zach Wilson doesn't like try to lose them games. It's like watching the old Bears where it's like you just need a quarterback who doesn't lose you the game and they'll be fine with their defense. But he has to perform a little bit for Breece Hall not to just get stuff all the time. He's looking really good. He's getting a lot of touches. So I like him long-term more than Mostert just from a health perspective too. I know he was banged up last year, but I think Mostert's still more injury prone and they're still going to split things once Achane comes back. Pickens, I don't know. The whole Pittsburgh offense looks terrible. I know I have their whole backfield, but because of that, I've watched them play more and I just don't trust anyone on their team. Their offensive line looks terrible.
It's bad.
They get stuffed more than anyone. Pickett doesn't really have a ton of time. And when he does, he doesn't really make good decisions. He's at least throwing Pickens the ball more, which is helping because before he wasn't even targeting. And now he's at least throwing the ball. So he's looked good recently. I just don't know if that's sustainable. So
yeah.
I like the move for Peel. He's got some really solid running backs with, you know, him and Pollard. So I like the guys that he's got. He's got some younger guys. They're going to continuously put up solid points and just kind of create a good base for him.
Yeah, I tend to agree with that. I gave Peel a ton of shit when this first happened. I was like, dude, what are you smoking? You just gave away a guy that had 11 touchdowns and is like the primary back. He's fast as all hell. on a high octane.
I mean, like, that's the thing with trades is you never know, right? Like, Mostert could just, like, keep it up and have an unbelievable season because Miami's offense is just that much better than everyone else. But
I just don't know
if it's sustainable.
I eat my words because I was like, you know, as much as I love CMC and he's so good, I'm like, I just – when Elijah Mitchell was healthy last year and CMC was there, like, Elijah Mitchell ate into the CMC work. But, like, me being a fool, like, a full offseason with CMC being on that team, obviously, is going to make them prep for him more than they had time to when he got moved over there mid-season last year. So I always just – it's tough for me with two running backs on a team. But, like, we've already seen Achane and Mostert, like, both be great on the same team together. And I think that's just the way that offense works. And Mike McDaniels just loves freaking – fast ass running backs. So, like, these guys both have Mostert does not really look like he's lost a step, which is impressive at 30. To be one of the fastest running backs in the league, like, it's impressive.
Yeah. I just worried, is he too fast? Is he gonna hurt himself? Like, I feel like that's why he gets hurt. He's just moving too fast.
The hamstrings, yeah. No, yeah. I get that too. I do agree. I am higher on Breece than I am Mostert the rest of the season. But again, I also feel like this is like one of the foolish things where we're just like rooting for fantasy and not actual football. And like our eyeballs are seeing Mostert be better than Breece's right now, but we're like, that can't sustain somehow, some way. And I think that's what Mick does. Like, I just think that's where Mick beats the rest of us up because he just likes the football aspect of fantasy and not the fantasy aspect of football. And he's just like, these guys are good players. So I'm going to put them on my team. Again, I'm still not convinced that he knew that David Montgomery played for Detroit when he drafted him. I'm pretty sure he thought he was still a Chicago Bear.
There's a lot of things that I'm questioning in general. It's about decision-making with that man. But he beat me, so I can't really speak to it.
That's what I'm talking about.
He traded his best player to you so I can play him again. So I feel like he's just out to get me. And I'm going to lose to Mick again this week. And it's just really disappointing.
Okay, so if you're ranking that trade, who are you in favor of on that trade? And do you think it's an A+ trade?
Peel's trade?
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know. That one's pretty even. I feel like I got to roll a little bit for Sean just because of how hot Pickens is right now.
Yeah.
But this could be one where I just like eat my words. Those two guys are playing really well right now. If it were me, I would have maybe tried to throw in somebody a little bit lower than Pickens, but I don't know Peel's team intimately to know what his wide receiver base looks like. But I think long terms, I think Peel's got a really good chance of coming out on top because Breece Hall is going to be in there every week. It's really just for me is Breece Hall going to outperform Mostert for the rest of the year?
Yeah. They also gave up on the Dalvin Cook experiment. Like, that's over. He's just done. He's just cooked at this point.
He looks awful. He looks really bad.
I honestly I didn't mean to say cooked with a pun either, but I'm glad it worked out. Okay. Let's, if you had to grade that, where would you put that? Is it an A+ trade? Is it an A trade? Is it?
I don't know what the grading system means for trades.
B+. Okay, it's a B+ trade for you. It's a great B+ trade.
Yeah.
All right, let's move on to the other trade. I'm going to let you take the floor on this trade and just tell me what your thoughts are.
Yeah, so like I said, I just haven't had a lot of time to prep. It just feels like you gave Mick half your bench players for the best fantasy football player maybe in history this year. It's just on like an unbelievable scoring pace. And I feel like it's really targeted at me personally right now because you're playing me this week. I felt like okay about our matchup if I had maybe some guys who were healthy and were going to play. And then I saw that Mick just gave you his best player. And I'm like, oh, okay, that's cool. I guess I'll just lose or die.
Guess,
I don't know.
Guess I'll die.
Yeah, like I think I have like maybe a 2% chance to win this week. So just feeling really down in general. So that's how I feel about the trade personally. I think if we add it up, I think it'd be an interesting exercise to add up those four players like total points and just compare it to Tyreek Hill, because I think it's probably close. because one of those players was literally a free agent and I don't think is actually going to play this week. So that doesn't really count.
Are you talking about Evan? Evan Hall?
The guy on the Rams.
Yeah.
Who's not going to play.
I wavered him for $12. I wavered him.
I mean, that doesn't add value to him.
No, I'm just saying it wasn't a free agency pickup. It wasn't like snagged him off the bench and threw him in a trade.
I mean, he basically was, though. I don't think anyone else bid on him.
I think someone else bid on him. Mick bid on him. Mick bid on him, as a matter of fact.
You logged on to Mick's account and bid on him?
Yeah. Just to show there was
you some sly dog, you.
Look at guys. I swear he wanted him.
Just outbid him. I don't think anyone did bid, man. I gotta look this up. I gotta fact check this for the people.
Here, league overview. Let's look at
I never look at Yahoo on my computer. So I have no idea how to navigate this stuff. So I just have to go to my phone.
Yeah, it is a little easier.
It's been
there.
15 transactions since then.
Well, yeah, it's all peel. I told you just 12 moves today. Like, look at that. It's so crazy. So many. While you do that, I'm just going to Zach Evans, not Evan Hull. Evan Hull's on Indianapolis. We're talking about Zach Evans.
Yeah. Oh, there was two other offers. Yeah, Mick, you logged on to Mick's account, put a $2 bid on.
Well, who was the other offer outside of Mick?
Oh, but Peel bid on everyone.
Peel can't bid. He can't bid on anyone. He's
$0.
$0 bids. Yeah, $0 bids. Yeah.
So, yeah. I mean, every single one, I think he tried to get some action. And the guy just loves transactions.
He does. That he
loves transactions. So he's all about transactions. So I got to appreciate it.
Yeah. Look, here's the breakdown of it for me. I'm just chasing an alpha receiver. We know what Tyreek Hill is. So there's no justification on my end that I need to give. I was just chasing as top of guys as I can get. Oh,
yeah, no, it's very obvious why you would make this trade from your point of view. And for Mix, it's like one man's trash is hopefully another man's treasure is what I'm hoping.
He had Nick Chubb at the beginning of the year. Chubb went down week two. Ford's his backup. I know that Kareem Hunt is there, but Kareem Hunt also got cut from that team. So it's like
Kareem Hunt, though, I think, I mean,
he got a little work 2 weeks ago.
He got a lot of work last week.
2 weeks ago. They had a bye this past week.
Oh, yeah. The last time he played.
This is also another big part of why Mick wanted to make this trade was because he's worried about injuries to the running back position. He did have Montgomery, who won't play this week, and he's got Gus Edwards as his next best back. So, like, he had nothing. He had absolutely nothing. And then,
I mean, yeah, you can't justify it to me. It's between you and, the big man. So
I'm telling you Mick's justification, not my justification for Mick. These are Mick's words.
Is that what you type in when you log into his account and make the transaction?
Dude,
or
I'm all on ChatGPT. Like, I just say to ChatGPT, like, act like my compassionate father-in-law who feels like getting worked over on a trade. Oh, you poor thing. Let me give you the best receiver in the league and you can just give me what you feel is right, my man.
Yeah.
Give me what you feel is right.
Yeah, it does kind of feel like that where you just you just really hustled him and it's like a Christmas present early for you. There's just so many things. I just wish it was next week that you did this and not this week, because now we can't even really make a side bet. Like, there's no
Oh, sure we can. What's
no,
the
I mean, like, it's
Hill?
So lopsided. It's so lopsided. It's not even funny.
Fantasy pros. So ECR, this is important to point out, does have it in my favor, believe it or not, obviously. Ooh. Yeah, if you can't imagine that this one's in my favor. This is going to move me up in the power rankings 3.8% to Mix 2.2%. So it does.
I just don't know how it makes mixed teams better, but.
Well, Pacheco's a starter. Ford's a starter. Amari
RB2.
Cooper. Yeah, RB2.
No, Pacheco's an RB2. Ford's maybe a flex player on most teams.
I think so. I think in a 10-man league at best. Yeah, probably.
Yeah, I don't even know if he's a 10-man league. He's probably RB30, something like that?
28. I mean, you're right. Yeah, you're right. Like, he's right. And Pacheco's 16. So, like, he is getting two RB2s. He's getting
RB2 flex. Yeah.
And a mid range WR2 with Amari Cooper.
For the best player in the world.
Yeah. And here's the other thing too. Like, I get it. I understand it too. But the thing is, it's like, negotiate with me. Like, I'll negotiate left and right. Like, I would have probably ended up moving up to I think Saquon was like my line for something like that, to get like Saquon involved with that trade would have been,
like I said, you just, you have to, you know, deal with the big man at the end of the day. It's great. And
it's great. We, we're in constant talks. Let me tell you.
Where are you? Need Jesus.
I have him on speed dial. So, but the trade is my favorite part of the trade was, so Peel and I have had some back and forth throughout the year, and he is like, dude, if Tyreek Hill ends, like this was week two, he's like, if Tyreek Hill ends up on your team, I'm just done. He's like, I'm just done. And I know it's going to happen. He's like, yeah, it's just a matter of time before it happens. He's like, I will be done, and you will piss off this league if you make that trade. So what did I do? I went to Carlos first. I'm like, what can we do to get Diggs on my team? Like, but then everyone was already mad at the first trade I made with him, which is not really panning out that much for me. I mean, Hurts is playing well.
I mean, Jalen Hurts is incredible. He's the only reason you've won. I mean, you would have been in a terrible spot without that, because you would have had Aaron Rodgers, and that was it.
I think it would have been
starting Sam Howell.
I think I would have picked up Brock Purdy. Brock Purdy was available. I would have picked up Brock Purdy. But he sucked last week.
It's hard to say what you would have done, because you just trade raped someone again.
So
yeah, nice sweatshirt, by the way, man.
Hey, you too. Longer fucking Nita's. Yeah, I mean, I think all this does for Mick is just like level him out a bit. I don't if I'm Mick, I wouldn't have made the trade. If that makes everybody in this league feel better.
I think if everyone's Mick, they wouldn't have made that trade.
I think if everyone is, can we just talk about some stuff though about Mick's roster though? David Montgomery, when healthy, he's RB9 rest of the season, and he's going to miss some time. So he's like the RB2 behind CMC.
It's just determination though, and raw grit that's got him here this far, and having the best receiver, or not just the best receiver, the best player in fantasy football. And then Travis Kelce is the best tight end by far. And then like Montgomery overperforming has been great. Thielen is apparently a top 10 receiver again.
Yeah, what the fuck?
So yeah, I mean, I already lost to Mick. I'm going to play his best player again this week. So pretty excited. In a really good spot mentally.
Yeah,
now.
I can tell. You haven't brought it up at all.
I haven't brought it up. Yeah. Not in ninth place. Feel like I'm in 11th.
Yeah, so his team now looks like this. David Montgomery, Isaiah Pacheco, Jerome Ford. So he actually has a running back room now. At least two players that he can play that are going to do something. And then a flex in Ford. And then Gus had, and again, Ford and Cooper are both passed by. So he gets a free week out of this that he doesn't have to worry about, with figuring it out. DJ Moore, Amari Cooper, Adam Thielen. So like he's got a good 3-3, but they're, to me, they're WR2s and RB2s.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Outside of Montgomery, everybody else is like in the two range.
The difference is though, like Tyreek Hill scores enough, like as many points as three players do. So like he takes up one roster spot where those other three players take up three. So
yeah. Yeah. But you do got to play the other position, but I know what you're saying. Like, I'd rather get 3 points from a running back so I can get the 53 from Hill. So I'll just take 56 for two positions compared to the 15-15, you know what I mean? Like that's your approach. And that's where I would come from as well.
Yeah, but I would just rather have the one guy who's really good. Yeah. I think anytime it's like a one for two, like it's always, you're always kind of questioning like, is that really fair? But
yeah, I get it. Again, it's one of those things where, you guys all have to live with it. I don't
know what the trade committee is doing. Even actually know if the trade committee is real now. I'm just, like I said, there's a lot of questions.
Peel was pretty irate, and I actually encouraged him. So I won't share the conversation, but I will just say, I'm not on the trade committee. It's just Peel and Carlos. So they go back and forth and figure it out. Carlos approves. Yeah, Carlos approved right away. I don't know if you'd believe it, but he approved right away. And then Peel was like, all I had said was, this is another PSA. Trades have to be processed within 24 hours or else Yahoo will just push it through. So I just need to know whether or not what their vote is within 23 hours, because if I have to decline it if it's not done before it goes through and gets that, because they need to be unanimous if they're voting together on something. So, but Pia was just like, I'm at work. I don't want to look at this right now. He, you know, I think he saw Tyreek Hill and then just was like, fuck this. I'm not, there's no way. But he put up a stink, but then was like, I approve, 'cause it's not collusion. So integrity move, but
yeah, integrity. That's what it's all about. That's what it comes down to at the end of the day
for some people. Yeah.
Some people, that's really important.
I wonder what that's like. Let's just shift the conversation. Let's just go into the next thing. Let's just move right past it.
Yep.
Last week's matchup. So we went over some of this earlier. Do you want to do these? Do you have Yahoo up? You want to go through week six?
Like I said, I got to figure out how to navigate.
To navigate.
Navigate.
All right.
I got to figure out how to navigate Yahoo on the web browser here.
I'll cover that. And you're mad at me about trades and you can't even pull up the fucking platform on your web browser. And you're...
Well, I just look at it on my phone. I guess I could just look at it on my phone again.
Yeah. So we had 122 to 118, which was actually, believe it or not, one of the higher scoring matchups of the week. For the Menace over Nick's team, 137 to 95, which was the Bandits and the Blood Brothers. We had 137.12 to 102. Camper Dude squeaking out with the 117 to 114.
Always finds a way to win, man.
Sure does. They took a walk past my house, and it was on Sunday. We were setting up some other Halloween decoration stuff. And it was like, how are you feeling about fantasy? He's like, oh, I'm cooked. Like, that was mixed words, midday Sunday.
Yeah.
And then comes out with this on Monday. Just like,
I thought he had no chance Eckler coming back. Eckler, like I said, I think it's self-collusion there is the only explanation that makes sense. I don't know how that man scores 10 points.
Yeah.
That's it.
It wasn't even like they tried to ease him back in because he got plenty of volume. He got used plenty, and I think Herbert just didn't use him as much as he should have in the passing game. So, and then the last one was Hunter Biden's laptop making a 2-win streak here, 2-4 now, 114 to 105 over Molman. So those are the big implications that happened this week. Was Hunter Biden's laptop is now making a competitive and compelling case, like, to get back in this thing. And Hans Molman falling now puts him in third place. There's a gap for third place now. It's a 3-3 record is a tie for third. And then 5-1 is your second and first place. So, like, a 4-win is going to move you up.
Yeah, this is a big week with everyone being 2-4 or 3-3. So,
yep.
Really important week. That's why it's important, like, this matchup and not getting fucked by a trade.
Right. I would not know what that's like.
Last time I bring it up, sorry. Not salty.
I just doubt it.
But yeah, no, it's a really important week for everyone, matchup wise. Mick, unfortunately, like I said, I think this is going to be the demise of his team.
You can't even not bring it up by just talking about Mick. Stop talking about it for yourself. Now you're just talking about it for him.
But yeah, I mean, yeah, important week. Do you want to talk about this week?
Yeah, let's talk about this week. Start with any matchup you want to talk about.
I don't know. Let's start with what's the closest. Let's talk about Mick and Jeff, like, okay. Second and third place team. You know.
Yep. So it's tough to pick. I mean, I'll probably end up having Jeff in this matchup just because he's built even on his bench too. Like, he doesn't have Aaron Jones. If Aaron Jones goes, I'm going to throw him in. And then move some stuff around, right? Like, I would.
Yeah, Aaron Jones is. I don't know what's going on with him. He's been injured for like 3 or 4 weeks now, right?
Well, he came back. He played week two. He didn't play week two. He got injured against the Bears, so he missed 2 and 3, and then came back for week four, and he just was 5 for 18, 2-1, and then got injured in that game. Then week five. Didn't play. They went into bye last week, so now he should be back this week. It's a hamstring injury. That's the thing.
Like, yeah.
We don't know the severity of it, but if he's going to play this quickly afterwards, I think it was just mild, obviously. But
yeah, and it's after a bye, so I feel like it's probably his best chance for coming back. If he doesn't come back this week, I'd be pretty concerned about him overall. But he's got options with the two San Francisco backups. The problem is, I think once if it's not McCaffrey, it's running back by committee with everyone else who's healthy.
Yeah.
So it's like, which of those guys do you pick? So tough decision for Jeff, I guess. If McCaffrey's out, I guess maybe you throw him like Michael Thomas or somebody. If Aaron Jones does and McCaffrey don't go.
Yeah. Yeah. Miles Sanders is out and on bye too, so not an option. But he still has Mahomes and AJ Brown and Alexander Mattison, who is going up against San Francisco's defense. And I don't love that, but Sam Laporta, I know you regret that trade.
I can't really play Laporta over Andrews ever. I could have played him over Jerry Jeudy recently.
You could have played. You could have pulled the Mick and done two tight end set.
So that would have been a good option. I probably should have tried to get Kirk, but I was really down on Trevor Lawrence because he's been garbage this year. He's been, yeah. I feel like, the reason I'm in the place that I'm in.
Yep.
And I don't know who his backup is, even if he does. It doesn't seem like he's going to go because I can't place any bets on him. So I trust Vegas more than I trust Yahoo for if guys are actually going to play or not.
Yeah.
So I feel like he may not go, or there's a good chance he doesn't go on Thursday.
Yep. The other thing on Jeff's bench, or not on his bench, but looking at Puka Nacua over these past 2 weeks, Philadelphia and Arizona. So Philadelphia in week 5, he put up 20 points, 11 targets. Cooper Kupp was back that week too. So, and he got a touchdown. He was 7 for 71. So it was interesting to see that he got used that much, because I thought when Kupp came back, he dropped down to like 7 or 8 targets.
No, I feel like he's going to play that old, like, Bobby Trees role. And he's just going to be utilized a ton. I talked to Jeff quite a bit when we were like doing that trade. And, I feel like he's going to be solid all year. Nacua, like, the guy looks good. He's a rare case where like a rookie's just dropping right into an offense and performing right away. Yeah. Like he looks like a year two wide receiver from week one. So, great grab for the Rams. You know, McVay knows what he's doing. Pittsburgh's team is awful. So I expect my only chance this week is if Cooper Kupp scores 40 points, I feel like. And Nacua could also put up 40 points this week. Like, they're just going to completely dominate Pittsburgh secondary, because I think they have one of the worst secondaries in the league.
Wasn't there a week last year that Cooper Kupp had 22 targets and like 18 catches for like 260
yards? Maybe there. The thing is, he could still do that without Kyren Williams.
I know. Like,
they might just throw the ball every time.
I know. Yeah. Over on Mick's side of the ball, I have to assume he's going to put Cooper in his lineup, Pacheco in his lineup. And I don't know. This is the thing. Like, I just don't know how to predict Mick, but like, in all seriousness, I don't know if he's going to take Kmet out and put Jerome Ford in over Kmet, which is what I would be doing that. But I just don't know if that's what he's going to do. Or you got to take Gus Edwards out too. And Montgomery. So like, I don't know what he's going to do, but it doesn't really matter to me. I think Jeff has this one on lock.
I mean, for Mick, it hurts that Cousins matchup is against San Francisco. You can't really start him against San Francisco. That
with
defense
no Justin
so
Jefferson.
Good.
With no Justin Jefferson.
Yeah, so you can't do that. Thielen being out, with him being, I don't know, maybe like the wide receiver 10 on the year or something like that. The guy's a monster. That really hurts Mick. DJ Moore having a D2 quarterback thrown to him is going to be interesting. It'd be a tough week to start two Bears receivers, but if Mick does it, I believe that they're going to do well. So,
so do we just take Mick in this?
And I don't think we can. I mean, if he would have had Hill, I think I would have given it to him, but, without that like explosive person that can put up 40 points, I think it's going to be hard. AJ Brown could have a huge week, because Miami, like, I think that's probably gonna be the highest scoring, game of the week. Philadelphia's defense is not playing as well, and I think they're a little dinged up too. So I'd like the explosiveness of Jeff's team. I think Jeff's team could put up a ton of points this week.
If you took the under on games this year, you would be at like a 60% win rate, which is the highest since 2000. I think they were saying it's insane to me. It's insane.
Football
has been bad this year.
The quarterback play has been pretty poor this year. I feel like there's been a lot of sacks. I didn't realize Khalil Mack had 6 sacks in one of the weeks. Like, I feel like that hasn't been talked about enough.
Yeah.
And 6 sacks against the Raiders, they were saying, which is pretty crazy.
He looked good the other night, too. He had a couple sacks in that game. He's looking really good right now. I think a lot of us forgot about Mack in general because, like, after he was in the Bear, I stopped paying attention to him as much. So there's that. But he was, like, banged up for a long time. So he just wasn't really out there that much. But you forget when he is, he's special. So, okay. So I'll pick the next one here. Let's go with the next closest matchup to me. And that would probably be Bone City and Blood Brothers. It's a 10th and a 6th place matchup, but it's a 2-4 and a 3-3 record. Off the bat, I think I like Brett's team more in this. I think Zach would have to really do a lot with Brandon Cooks on bye to put in, and so I think his only option to do that is to put in Godwin against the Falcons. But Godwin's not going to make up the point differential on there, so. Lamar, I think, has a good matchup against Detroit this week. Metcalf in Arizona is great if he plays. He's questionable right now, but I don't know. Those rib injuries are weird. That's the thing. Like, sometimes you sit out 1 week, sometimes you sit out 4 or 3.
DK is another guy I feel like who will play if he has the chance. Devontae Adams, I'm more worried about for Brett. Just with Hoyer being in there, I don't even know if they really need Devontae Adams to beat the Bears right now. He didn't really do a whole lot last week. I don't know if their quarterbacks are good enough to use Devontae Adams, is my concern with Vegas. I don't know Hoyer as well. Maybe he's got a little bit more arm strength than Garoppolo, but it'll be interesting to see what they do with Adams. I mean, the Bears are terrible, so he could have a giant week. Just depends if Hoyer can get him the ball.
Yeah, and I know he's nursing a shoulder, so we'll see. I have Swift as my number 3 running back this week, which I cannot believe that I'm saying that, but I really do. I'm happy Philly got, like, for fantasy sake, and Brett too, because I know he took a gamble on Swift for, like, what, $5?
Like, yeah, I mean, I think Swift is great. Robinson's going to be great against the Giants. That's going to be an ugly game. I think it'll be an ugly game, but we'll be competitive. So I think Robinson will get a lot of usage. Waller has been super disappointing.
He was like my must-have target going into the year, too. He's like one of those guys that I was going to try to spend a big on, and then I just like
hit
my threshold. I was like, I got Hawkinson before Waller went up. So it's like, oh, okay, I guess I'm out for that.
Yeah, I think Ayuk will have a great game.
Debo, too. And that's against Minnesota. Monday night game, so we're going to see primetime Kirk.
It's always a highlight. This one will be interesting to watch on Monday if it's close to with Kittle going for Zach.
I'm just, like I was saying, I'm happy that Philly got their head out of their asses and we're like, oh, okay, yeah, Swift is just like the best guy we have in this room. We don't need to fuss around with 5 other freaking running backs like we always do.
It's nice to see a team make that decision and just like move forward with it.
They puttered around with it for like 2 weeks and then they're like, oh, okay, you're right. We did have Kenneth Gainwell on our roster for 2 years prior and he wasn't good. So why would he be better now?
Yeah. Why would things be different this year?
Yeah, so Josh Allen is maybe not going to go, but he says he's going to go. He probably will. It's against New England. So I don't know if that's like a run-heavy game for them or not. It'll be interesting to see like what the shoulder strength is. I'm super down on Drake London this year, but I'm curious your take. You have him somewhere else.
Yeah, he looked great last week. I just don't. The play calling in Atlanta is not great for any of their receivers, and their game script is should be one where they're throwing the ball constantly, but they're just not. So, not really sure what they're trying to do there. He had some incredible catches last week. I think if they can do some better play calling, he can put up 20 points easily if they throw him the ball. They just haven't been throwing him the ball. It's watching him in Pitts is incredibly frustrating.
Yeah.
So I really didn't want any part of Atlanta's offense. I hate having good players on bad teams. That's exactly what he is. The problem is it's going to be 20 points or it's going to be 2 points. I feel like there's very little in between. This projection on Yahoo of like 12 points, I don't know if that'll ever happen for him.
They're just trying to split the difference. That's all they're trying to. They're just trying to, you know, my thing with London is I actually, maybe hot take here, but like I think he's a top five guy if he's on another team. And the problem is Atlanta's good. Atlanta has what, lost three games this year? That's it. So they're in first place in the division, right? Am I wrong on that?
Maybe. I don't know. I haven't been paying attention to that division.
Yeah, I mean, Atlanta is winning football games with the way that Arthur Smith puts that offense together. So like it's like Dan Campbell. He's like, I'm not gonna change it because you want me to. If it works, I'm gonna do it. And for us, it's like okay, but you realize what you have on the team that you're not using too. He's like, I don't give a shit.
Yeah, they don't give a shit about fantasy football. So
right, exactly. So and that's the mixed strategy. He's like, I don't give a shit what you guys want. I know what's gonna, you know, give me David Montgomery. What's his name?
Because they're in second in the NFC South.
Yeah. Oh, they're in second. Yeah, I figured they were either first and second with their record. So who's in first in that division?
The Bucks. So this is like four first place. The Bucks are only in first because they're 3-2 versus 3-3.
Right. Yeah. So Atlanta's the better team there, obviously, but
we'll find out this week.
We are gonna find out this week. Hollywood, Bijan, Josh Jacobs. Josh Jacobs is not doing it for me this year. He's not doing it for me this year,
but I think against the Bears with Brian Hoyer as a quarterback, this should be his top week of the year.
Oh, Yahoo is under on him. He's RB4 this week. Don't get me wrong. He's going to get like 22 points at minimum. But I'm talking outside of that. Like, I know it sounds crazy to say, you know, a 28-point game and then a 20-point game. But, like, before that, he was 10, 10, 11, and 11. Like, those are his other numbers outside of 27 and 20. And the 12-point game in week 6 is off 25 carries and 5 targets. He's 2 for 16, 77 yards on the ground. Like, just kind of ugly numbers to get you 11, you know, under 11.5 points. Like, that's a lot of volume to not do anything with. So, but I don't think that's a Josh Jacobs problem. I think that's a Vegas problem.
Yeah. I think this is going to be one of the closer games. I feel like there's a really good chance that it comes down to that Monday night mashup with Ayuk and Kittle.
Yeah.
I'd much rather be the Ayuk owner in that matchup than Kittle. I think Kittle's a better football player, but unfortunately he's not necessarily designed to be a fantasy tight end. He's just a fantastic tight end.
Yeah. I think Washington's going to do more with Dotson this week too, by the way, against the Giants. I think they have to get him going. If they don't do it this week, then
Samuel's been their top receiver, right? I mean, like, it's,
yeah,
I don't know. It's weird.
Well, I've said it all year. Scary Terry's dealing with that turf toe, and you know, Curtis Samuel is the guy, because Dotson's more of a deep threat than anything, and they're not going to feed him. They aren't using him the way that they should. It's like Marvin Mims on Denver. It's like their best receiver, and they just aren't designing anything for him.
Yeah, Denver's awful. It's horrible to watch. I don't want to watch another Broncos game the rest of the year.
So if you're not a Bears fan, would you rather watch the Bears or the Broncos this year?
I'd rather watch the Bears. I mean, the Broncos, the product is terrible. Russell Wilson is not a good quarterback. He has great receivers around him with Mims, Sutton, and Judy. And Mims, when he gets the ball, is like one of the most electric guys in the NFL. And I'm glad he's returning punts. I actually just want to watch their punt returns and like kickoff returns. That's really it.
That's your alley rule.
The rest of their defense or offense is hard to watch.
Yeah. All right, so who do you take in this one?
Brett's just had some bad luck. I'm really pulling for Brett. I think I'm gonna go with Zach though. I mean, honestly, I'm a little concerned about Adams with a backup quarterback. I think his projection's probably high with Hoyer throwing the ball. And Buffalo's defense is probably going to score 20 points. So New England's really, really bad on offense. So I think Buffalo is going to have double-digit points easily. And Atlanta's defense is not going to. So I think that's going to be like one of the bigger point differentials for the two of them, unfortunately.
Okay.
And I think defense is going to have a bigger impact on this game than Brett may like.
Yeah, that's fair. Division matchup with Tampa Bay and Atlanta for Brett. They're the 20th ranked defense of the week, but I still will take Brett because I just don't see how Zach fills that Cook spot that he's got lingering, not filled right now. I mean, it's going to be Godwin, but I don't see Godwin getting 18 points to beat Brett out if we're just going on sheer projection alone.
Yeah. You know. Yeah, and I think Palmer is going to do better than what Yahoo's projecting, like 9.5. I think Chargers will bounce back a little bit this week. Last week their offense underperformed. I think they should have scored. They should. I'm shocked they're not scoring 30 points every week.
Yep, they get down quick in that game too. You just never know. All right, let's go to which one do you want to go to? I picked that last one.
Let's see.
We're gonna do ours last, for the record.
Yeah, let's do Biden's laptop and kickers are people too.
Okay, two guys here is the same thing as before. You're the seventh place team and the fifth place team. I mean, Carlos turned it around this past 2 weeks, like you talked about. He's got to play Geno this week. If you look at his bench right now,
yeah, tough week for Carlos from a buy standpoint. I mean, he's really all in on Cincinnati, which really hurt him at the beginning of the year. With Burrow, should have been on the IR, but just decided to play those 4 weeks and hurt the entire offense.
Yep.
Seems to be back, which is great for Carlos. Geno Smith against Arizona's, I mean, not a bad play. I'd be excited about that. Diggs is Diggs against New England is going to be great for him.
Yep. Yep.
But still hard to replace that Chase Burrow connection and like how big that swings things for him. So this, one touchdown's worth what? I mean, more than 12 points because you get the reception in there too. So at least 13.
Right.
With each touchdown that Chase scores. So it's gotta be a great feeling.
To get those guys back. Really
hurts.
Yeah. Yeah. The trade that I originally tried to make for him was for Burrow and he wouldn't give him up. So Hurts was what he wanted to dish out because he thinks Hurts is an average quarterback. He does not think Hurts is a good quarterback.
The stack can be really exciting, and like especially when you got like the Chase Burrow stack or like the Diggs Allen stack, right, where you get guys that score a lot of touchdowns, get a lot of yards. It makes or breaks you. But what happened the first 4 weeks for Carlos is like that just broke him. I mean, like that was tough. So sometimes it, like the stack can work great, but when it's not working for you, you just lose. You lose a lot.
Yeah, so, and no stack this week at all.
No stack this week, too. So, yeah, that's tough.
The other tough part about it is for him, so my two weakness spots on his team is Devonta Smith being the second guy that he has to go to now, or your like flex spot that you're trying to fill, because he's so hit or miss. And I don't know why experts are as high on Devonta Smith as they typically are. They still have him ranked as WR13, and when you look at his numbers, they're just ugly to me. Like 10 targets in week one, 17 points. Week two, yeah. 5 targets for 23, and this is what I expect from him. He goes 4 for 5 for 131 and a touchdown. That's exactly what I expect from him. But if it's not that touchdown and it's 4 for 5 for 28, which is what it was the following week, it's 6.8. it's just like, he is either going to get that big play or he's not. And if that big play goes for a touchdown, he does what you need him to.
Yeah. His PPR value is a lot lower, I think, than it is in other formats. He's another one of those guys that scores 20 points or he scores 2.
Yep.
So I've never been high on this guy. I don't want any part of him. Just because I hate that disappointment of, knowing that you watching those games can be so frustrating where you just like, throw him the ball. And
or he gets that one target and it's overthrown by a little bit and you're like, okay.
Or he drops the ball and then, Jalen Hurts is like, fuck this guy. I'm not throwing it in the rest of the day. I got other options.
I have Kenneth Walker as RB2 this week against Arizona. That part of the trade has worked out very well for Carlos.
He's looked great. I mean, with him and Smith, he's just going to be riding Seattle this week instead of
Yeah.
Instead of Cincy, right? So I mean, that Arizona matchup, you feel good about that at least. So
right.
He'll get points on every touchdown that they score, and you just got to hope for a high scoring game there. Arizona's been frisky. Arizona's been staying competitive. So like, you're almost, I'm more excited with that matchup than I would have been at the beginning of the year, because I would have thought that would have just been an easy roll for Seattle, but should be a good game.
I don't understand how Yahoo is underprojecting him so much. His lowest was 10.7 all year. The second lowest was 13.9. He's got two 18-point games and one 30-point game on top of that. But they're going to put him at 13.5 points, like against Arizona, who ranks third against running backs. It just doesn't make any sense to me.
Yeah. I mean, I think weathermen do Yahoo's projections and they're fine with being wrong. You know, 90% of the time, they'll still keep their job. So
right.
If you look at like those projections, and I love seeing like what's red versus green and how everyone did at the end of the week compared against Yahoo's matchup. But Yahoo's matchup really means nothing to me. Projections mean nothing to me.
The other part of Carlos's roster that just kills me is the Jerick McKinnon thing, and this is the folly of the auto draft. Is just, you got a couple of big names, Chase and Burrow, and Diggs, and then it was like, okay, we'll just take whatever we can get at this
point. Yeah, it's tough with the running back depth. I mean, he was. P. Ryan's not, I don't know. I hate Denver. I wouldn't do P. Ryan. Fuck that. No. I don't know. I don't know what I'd do with Carlos. Probably play McKinnon and just hope that he gets a couple of dump offs and some PPR points. Maybe he gets like four receptions and you're okay with 10 points. But
yep.
I think that's best case for McKinnon.
Yeah. Of all these matchups, this is going to be my lowest projected one of the week. I have right now, without him having a defense, and I have the line at 113-98. So like, I'll move up 7 points on that and put him at 105. So 113-105 for Nick. I mean, it's two against Philly, so that could either be should be a shootout. Olave Thursday night. I'm actually excited to watch him play a Thursday night game because I want to see Olave show up.
Can actually sit and watch him. Yeah, you can actually watch the quarterback play. Carr is healthier too. Like Carr was hurt a little bit earlier this year, so it seems like they're saying he's got velocity back. So should be a great matchup for Olave. Concerned about Jacksonville being competitive without Lawrence.
Yep.
So really, I think New Orleans could run away with that game if Lawrence isn't playing. But I think New Orleans will still continue to throw the ball. And yep. I mean, even if to Olave or Kamara, there's not a ton of other options on that team.
I actually hate saying this, but I like the Zach Moss play. I still don't think they've ramped up Jonathan Taylor to a point where they're comfortable giving him 18 carries.
I don't really know what they're doing there. I think Andy would have won last week if he would have played Zach Moss. And I think that would have been so like chef's kiss if he would have beat you with Zach Moss.
Oh yeah.
I
would have stood up at a slow clap there. Cause like at that point, you just got to take, you know, it's like when somebody knocks it out of the park on you and you just got to like take your hat off to the guy for the hit. That's what it would have been. I would have had to.
That would have been beautiful, but it didn't happen in such is life. And that's why fantasy football is just so cruel.
Yeah.
I mean, they're playing him. I don't know when Taylor's going to take over the backfield. It hasn't happened yet. And the only downside with the Zach Moss play is Cleveland's defense is absolutely unreal.
It's really good.
It's really good right now. I think Indiana's going to get murdered. Indianapolis, I don't know why I called them Indiana, but I maybe thinking of Mr. Jensen there, but I think they're going to get destroyed in this game. And I think Zach Moss he's going to get some snaps, but I don't think anyone's going to do well on Indies. I don't want any part of Indy this week.
He has my favorite tight end in the league just because, I mean, obviously, like, it's Kelsey and Andrews, and that's it. There's no third guy for me because they're not consistent enough to be third. Like, Hockenson's not a consistent third, and Kittle's not a consistent third.
Yeah, there's a drop-off. I mean, there's a huge drop-off after Kelsey.
Yeah.
Ingram gets a ton of targets, though, which is great.
But he puts up, like, 11 points a game, and it's just – you know what
he gets 10 targets every game. I mean, he gets 10 targets and Jacksonville has a lot of options too, which makes it really interesting. But like I said, if Lawrence doesn't play, I don't know how many targets people are getting. I don't know if they're throwing the ball 40 or 50 times if he isn't playing.
No, that's fair. But I'm just saying in general, like Evan Engram on a healthy Trevor Lawrence run team.
Yeah, he's great.
If he's getting good. 7 or 8, he has no touchdowns all year. And like, that's the differential from him being 10 or 16 or 19 or 20. Like he's just, that's it. And that's fine.
You just Jacksonville just hasn't scored a lot of touchdowns this year. That's the problem.
No, they haven't. You just want consistency from the tight end. So that's why I like that. The Mike Evans thing is peculiar. I don't know how he came off a hamstring injury and then went, you know, 10 for 4, 49. Like, either they're bad targets or he didn't look good. I didn't really watch that game, but they lost 20-6 in that gross Detroit game.
Yeah, Baker's been overperforming, though. So, I mean, you got to feel good about that if you're the Evans owner. So you just got to hope with that game script against Atlanta that – no one's really playing defense and that the score is high. I'm not sure what the over under is in that one. But
yeah, Gabe Davis, do we even need to? Like, you had him last year, didn't you?
Yeah, he's the same as he was last year. Some things never change. He'll have one game where he puts up 40 points. You just don't know what week that will be. Maybe against New England, actually. So like the matchup.
Who do you have in this one?
I have to go with Andy. Losing Chase and Burrow. Chuba Hubbard, I feel like would have been a nice play to have this week with his running back depth. I get worried that Kenneth Walker is the only player I'm really excited about. Him and Diggs. I'm excited about two matchups that Carlos has. Whereas I think Andy's got, other than Zach Moss, some really good matchups in going in his favor. The Tua against Philly, I think that's going to be a great game. So Olave, yeah. So I got to go with Andy.
Let's jump over to the only other matchups that's not ours then, and that would be Sean and Peel. This is our biggest differential in terms of ranking, but also very surprising in terms of how I would score this one out. Maybe just start with, who do you think is going to win this matchup?
Looking at this for the first time.
It's an interesting matchup.
Who does Peel have? I feel like Peel's got a lot of people. Oh, Hall and Pollard. Yeah. I mean, Peel's bench, that's tough with Williams, Pollard.
Yep.
Oh, man.
Yep. Well, and remember, like, this is the other thing. He traded into Breece Hall, and that was – I talked to Sean a little bit afterwards, and he was like, it was a smash except for me because I'm standing now because I'm tired of sitting. He's like, it was a smash for me because, you know, I get past my bye with Breece. I get this guy out of it.
I didn't realize they were playing each other with this trade that week. Man, right. I feel like you're going to feel like you won or lost that trade after this week.
Yeah.
I can't believe Peel pulled the trigger on that with playing against Mostert with Achane out. But
that was the other part of it that Sean was saying. He's like, I get to do this week and not worry about the piece that I trade away in this. And like, Sean's being savvy. He's like, I got to win now. So I need to do what I can to win now. And I'm sort of looking week to week rather than like what my rest of the season is like. So I love that for him.
I think I got to go with Sean on this one. I think by a decent amount. I mean, I like the Reynolds play by Peel. I think he's going to be leading Detroit's backfield. They don't like Jahmyr Gibbs. I don't know what he did to their offensive coordinator, if he's like sleeping with, you know, his wife or something like that. But
he might be
I like that play. He looked really good last week on Peel's side of the house. Love against Denver will be a good play, good backup for you know, Fields being out and Richardson being hurt, serviceable. Denver's trash. Don't like Pittman against Cleveland at all.
I love the Cleveland defense against it, the Colts too for Peel.
I think Peel's only chance is that Love Watson stack. If Watson puts up like 2 touchdowns or something like that and 100 yards, maybe Peel's got a chance here. I think that's what he needs.
Yeah, I think he just needs one of the randos on his team to like ball out. You know, those anomaly weeks that these guys have, I think he needs.
Yeah, Wandale. I mean, the Wandale play isn't bad on the Giants either. So like for the waiver wire pickups that Peel's had, I know he's the most experienced waiver person that I know.
Yeah.
And it shows with his starting lineup here. I think the Reynolds and Wandale Robinson are great starts for the situation that he's in. Cleveland's defense is great. So I wouldn't say he's out of it by any means, but I like Sean's lineup quite a bit more. Eckler's I'm not playing himself in fantasy this week. So
yeah, and he
should go back to scoring 20 points again.
Yeah, he's the RB1 this week for sure. I don't know, for me, if I look at it, I go, okay, Pitts has to score a touchdown. ETN has got to show up like he's shown up the past 2 weeks.
If Lawrence isn't playing, that could help him a ton.
Yeah, but it's also tough because New Orleans is really tough on running backs. It's a Thursday night game, too. Running backs typically do well on Thursday night games, though. So we'll see. And I think he just needs, he needs a lot more help than Sean does, to say the least. Like, I love McLaurin with the Giants, even as low as I am on him. It's a good matchup, and he will see close to double-digit targets, if not double-digit. Jordan Addison, I think, became the alpha with Justin Jefferson sidelined.
Yeah, I think he is. I think the Addison-Osborne thing here, they kind of cancel each other out, and against San Francisco's defense, I mean, they're going to be throwing the ball a lot because I think they're going to be down.
Monday night game, though. Monday night game. So that's when wide receivers show up, is the Monday night games.
But you know who doesn't show up on primetime games?
Kirk
Cousins.
So. That's very true. Mostert, it's just unbelievable stat line. I cannot, like, it, I'm looking at his sheet right now. He's got 1 week with no touchdowns, and that was against Buffalo when he ran 7 carries for 9 yards.
Yeah.
Yeah,
Sean needs a win. I would say I'm pulling for him, but he's, you know, one spot ahead of me in the ranking, so I'm not really pulling for him, but I am.
You gotta throw respect on this, that like he's playing Pickens here too, and he's playing, you know, he's playing all those guys. He's got Eckler back too, so that really hurt Sean, you know, most of the season. So like, I actually think Sean's got a good roster that he's put together here too, and he's got Garrett Wilson, who, that's unfortunate what happened with his value. You know, Boyd's just a guy, and Dalton Schultz is just a dude too. So like, those aren't buys that I'd be concerned about for him, you know, missing out on.
The Achan injury hurts. But I mean, Eckler and Mostert, don't really care. I guess like, you're still getting those points because they're going to Mostert. So, didn't really realize Sean had Achan in that trade too. Kind of interesting to have 3 Miami running backs on your squad, but I guess Jeff's doing the same thing with San Francisco running back. So
with the
you
way
just make
the
sure
health,
you have all that backfield.
I mean, why not? Right. If one guy goes down, you just know that the next guy, they've also all proven that they can do it. So like, I like the move. I hate that you like have to use a roster spot for that, but our benches are deeper than they've ever been.
I'd like to get rid of some of the bench spots next year. Personally,
you
feel like we have way too many.
Yeah. I like it. It made sense to put another one in with adding a roster, but I get the, Mari, we should put that up to a vote next year too.
I just think there's like, when you go to waivers and these bye weeks with injuries and stuff, it's hard to be excited about people that you're picking up.
Do you counter that by just adding a second IR spot then instead, because we increase the size of the team and injuries are, you're going to have more injuries naturally because you have more people on your team?
I don't know. I mean, I would have been able to have people constantly in 2 IR spots this whole season. Yahoo's really generous, at least with who you can put in your IR spot, because you can put people that are not actually on IR in there. So
yeah,
that's the only downside with it, is most people can probably have 1 or 2 guys in IR after week 3 or 4 for the rest of the season. So
I think what hurt Sean this year is Eckler being out and Gibbs being a bust. I think he was really banking on a 1-2 punch with Eckler and Gibbs.
I mean, the guy you pay a ton of money for, if he doesn't play for the first, you know, 5 weeks, for the first 6 weeks, whatever it is, because they had a bye in there too. But so 5 of the first 6 weeks, that's going to hurt your team.
Yeah, but like, all signs pointing to the Lions like using Gibbs like Swift, which they just haven't even decided to do yet, is killing him. It's killing
yeah.
him.
No, I remember texting the group week one, like when Gibbs got the ball. It's like, man, this guy looks great.
Yeah.
Excited for him to continue to get more usage.
And that was the last time we saw him do anything really electric was week one. Like,
and now with Monty hurt, you would be like, oh yeah, he's gonna be ready to go. And like,
we saw
he's
that
got a hamstring and
yep.
You know,
but we also saw him dominate backfield touches, I think, in week two when Montgomery didn't play. And yeah, 17 touches week three against Atlanta, and he went 17 for 80. And like, why aren't they throwing him the ball? He had 9 targets in week two and 5 in week four, but 2 that week that he was the prime. It just, I don't understand Dan Campbell, but I don't need to, because Dan Campbell understands himself just fine.
Yeah. Their Lions are doing great. So
yeah,
apparently they're like a top 6 football team this year, but who knows what happens with Monty going out. And
we're Sean on this one for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. Sean on this one for sure. For me.
Okay. All right. Last matchup. This is a barn burner for me, right?
Yeah.
I'm just going to call this straight. I think me by 1,000.
Yeah, I think this is the most lopsided matchup of the week. I need everything to go right for my team.
I've had some bad
luck. Let's talk about your team first, I guess. Let's yeah.
Sure. Yeah. Keenan Allen's looking really good this year. I'm excited that he was down on him. He was like not the guy I thought would have been my top guy. I thought Ridley would have been. So I'm happy that he has shown up and he became my top guy until Hill came over to the roster. I'm actually going to start Taylor with a little bit more confidence here. I know they're against Cleveland and it's going to be a tough matchup, but like my other options are more limited now that I've traded away. It's like Rashad White hasn't really done much for me and I don't really want to play him against Atlanta's defense. You know, they're
yeah.
pretty stout too.
I mean, yeah, you got rid of 4 bench players, so you're not going to have a lot of depth.
Right.
So
yeah, I get Deontay Johnson back probably this week too, but I still don't know if I can start him. I would start him over Taylor if I knew for sure that he was playing against.
I mean, that matchup's good for Pittsburgh and the Rams.
Yeah.
I think they're both going to be trying to score a lot of points.
Yep.
Which I can't say about some other teams. It seems like that would be an obvious tactic. Like you just try to score a lot of points, but
yeah.
Clearly that's not what the Jets are doing.
I feel like that's like how you try to win games.
Not what Cleveland's doing.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, working okay for them. So
I don't even need to touch Hill. Ridley concerns me if I'm being straight. Like, so Higgins and Ridley are a tale of two stories for me. Higgins and Ridley are getting like the same amount of volume target wise. Higgins just looks shitty right now. He's dropping stuff, which is not his end, but like he looks bad. So like
yeah.
Now they're on bye. I hope they figure it out while he's on bye, what's going on with him. But like Burrow's putting it on him. So that's on Higgins. The Ridley thing is more Trevor Lawrence looking like shit. And like he's getting targets, but they're just nowhere near catchable balls. And
yeah.
Whatever percentage I saw the other day of like Calvin Ridley percentage of catchable balls was like gross compared to what he's actually getting. So I think better days ahead, but
yeah, I know you were really high on him at the start of the year. And I think if Lawrence was performing where everyone thought he was going to perform, Ridley would have a great season. I think he had a really solid week one, didn't he?
He did. Yeah. He
had 24 and then
points.
Jacksonville's offense has kind of just dropped off. I've watched a lot of Jacksonville football with them playing in London, you know, those 2 games, right?
Yeah.
But like they're missing a lot of touchdowns just by a hair. So I think they can bounce back. I think with Lawrence being hurt this week, like I said, I don't think he's going to play, but we'll see. I mean, if he does play, I think I like the Ridley play. If he's not going to play, I don't know what I'd do with Ridley.
I can't. I don't have any other options. Higgins is out, and I can move Keenan Allen up and then, you know, put White.
You could just bench him. I would just not start no one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
You want the win to beat? I could probably bench him and still beat you.
Yeah, I'm sure you could. Fine.
Kamara,
I like Kamara a lot.
Yeah. So we talk about this really quick.
On him this week.
Can we talk about Kamara really quick? Kamara, in the first couple years, was all about PPR catches and like splash plays. Now he is just like a pure volume guy. It's such a different player now than he used to be. It's almost nothing like it used to be where he would just make these big plays. Now it's like 19 for 68, 22 for 80. You know, he did have week six where he caught 7 of 8 for 36, but these are not like I think the days of Kamara actually making these like big plays happen and looking special are over. And now he's just a pure volume play, and he's doing okay with it. The number drop off isn't as big, but it's not the Kamara I like watching.
I think it's a good matchup against Jacksonville this week, though. And
yeah,
there's not a lot of options on that offense. I mean, Olave's awesome. He's really been – Olave's had an off year, though, with Carr being hurt. That hurts everyone. But he's back. He's healthy this week. So I think Kamara will do well.
Yeah.
I think he'll get that 14.6 point projection.
Yeah, I want to figure out what the Vikings are going to do with Hockenson. Not – San Francisco. I mean, they're just going to guard him because I don't have much more. But I thought he'd get a lot more target tick up with Justin Jefferson being out. It didn't happen in the one game that he was out. So,
yeah, this is a tough week with San Francisco. So that's a tough matchup for him. But like I said, he should be one of the top receiver options there. Addison's looked really good, though.
Mm-hmm.
So Addison's usage has gone way up. Like I said, I don't like the Taylor matchup against Cleveland. So some tough defenses there. But Keenan Allen's going to score 40 points against Kansas City. So
if he doesn't get injured.
The Kansas City defense, I mean, Herbert, I don't know, he looked terrible this week. So maybe he'll be bad again.
There's only two guarantees in football. One of them is that Mick will always find a way. And that Mike Evans will have a hamstring injury some point in time in the season. And we've already seen the Evans thing, and we've seen Mick find a way. So there are two absolutes in fantasy
football. Yeah.
On your side of the ball, I actually love the Howell play this week too. And
yeah, I was actually talking with Zach about maybe trading for one of his quarterbacks. But I saw Howell was out there, and I was like, you know what, for this week, it's fine. I'm just really just frustrated with Trevor Lawrence overall. With the 6-point touchdowns, having a quarterback that doesn't throw touchdowns really hurts your team. I don't know if you understand that.
Not really.
With the trade that you did where you got like the best quarterback in the league for.
It's called the art of the deal, Ryan. Okay, just get better. That's what I would tell you. Yeah. My advice would just be just get better.
I need multiple teams next year. But Howell, I like the matchup this week for him. Guy runs. I hope he starts utilizing his wide receivers a little bit more.
Yeah.
So I'm excited to watch him play. I'm excited not to watch Trevor Lawrence play. So interesting part of that matchup for me. I think Kupp's going to have 1,000 points this week. So I think that's my only hope is if he goes off. Myers, I don't love that play with Jimmy G being out. Don't know what Hoyer's going to do, but do like the matchup against the Bears. If Garoppolo was in, I would have been really, really jazzed about that matchup for him.
Yep.
Myers, I think, is probably close to outscoring Devontae this year. Devontae's had a couple of off games the last few weeks, and Myers has really just been pretty consistent.
Yep. I love the Mark Andrews play this week, too. Obviously, he's just tight end to pretty much any given week. But Detroit is really generous against tight ends this year.
Yeah. Like I mentioned earlier, Roshan, not confident he's going to play this week, which really hurts me because I don't have anyone else to start, really. With the buys and the injuries, I have my top two running backs out with Connor and Mixon, so that kind of sucks. Amon-Ra has been great. That offense this week. Baltimore's defense has been performing better than expected the last few weeks. So they've been a nice snag for me, but I don't like the matchup against Detroit. May need to grab somebody there. But
what's your take on Dobbs here? I know you were just about to get to that, but what is
I like the matchup against Denver, honestly. So that's why I have him in there, other than the fact that like I don't want to play Jerry Jeudy anymore. I'd much rather watch Green Bay's offense, as much as it's hard to say, then watch Denver's offense. In that matchup, I'm going to be rooting for Denver.
Right.
But then I'm going to be disappointed in Russell Wilson. So it's kind of like
Bears fans. So you're used to the disappointment. You understand.
Yeah.
That.
I might throw caution to the wind and just throw in like, Rashi Rice or something like that too. Like, we'll see.
Ooh, I like that actually.
Real wild card. I'm sure you would like that.
But I like Dobbs this week. I do like Dobbs this week. I'm actually more confident in his 12 and 13 target games than I am in the other ones.
That dud that he had, I mean, I lost the week because he didn't get used at all in that 1 week. His usage was super high before. Yeah, I lost by like a couple points that week.
Yeah, he went 1 for 4 for 4 yards.
Yeah, so. And like that killed me. But other than that, his usage has been great. I was really concerned about what happens when Watson comes back. It seems like he's still getting decent usage. The problem is Jordan Love looks like he's getting worse every week. We'll see what version of the Packers show up this week. You can't ask for a better team to play against than Denver. I guess maybe Carolina, but Denver looks atrocious. So,
yeah, after this last week too, if the Bears don't intentionally tank and get the 1-2, then what are we doing as an organization?
Yeah,
like, this is not our future anywhere here. As much as that, like you should, if you're trying to salvage your GM job as Ryan Poles. How are you not on the phone every day to just pester trading Fields to Atlanta? Just like, how you feeling today? Fields to you guys. Like, we'll almost do it straight for your first round pick here. Like, just give us one. Like, sure, we'll take your second round pick for him at this point, right?
Fields just, to me, Fields just hasn't looked good when he's been in. I know he had one good week.
Two.
But like, watching his actual quarterback play, I still don't think he's really progressed that much. He's not reading defense as well. He can't make his progressions. Like, he gets a lot of the sacks that he takes, I think, are on him. I don't think they're on our offensive line as much as they're on him.
Our line has actually looked pretty good this year too.
They look way better than they looked last year. Fields holds on to the ball too long. And he doesn't, like, for how long he holds on to the ball, I feel like he should be on like his third or fourth option, but maybe he's on a second option.
Yeah, well, I think he's looking at his first option. I mean, obviously, he's looking at his first option to open up. I'm like, okay, where are you at in the route? I don't like, you're supposed to be further. You're not supposed to be there. And then, you know, it's just kind of like looks back at him and is like, gives him the stare of like, you idiot. You're the reason I'm having to look this way now, right?
Yeah, I don't know if he reads defenses quick enough.
Maybe not.
I think I saw that, was it Bajent or Bajent? How do you pronounce that guy's name?
Bajent.
Bajent.
Yeah.
I saw he was demanding that like they don't cut down the playbook for him. They don't need to treat him like a rookie. And I thought that was like kind of a shot at Fields in my mind, where like, yeah, they cut the book down a ton for this guy. I think it kind of shows the difference in like football intelligence between the two. And I think Bajent's probably a little bit he's gonna be quicker at reading the defense. The guy looks like he sees the field well. He had some like two really bad plays last week, but
get thrown in mid-game.
I think it's just a straight passer. He's better than Fields.
Probably. I don't know enough about him, honestly, and it's hard to make the comparison. Fields, I think, is just the better quarterback of the two.
Apparently, the guy owns like every D2 record in football. Like, if you like looking up some of his stats, I was listening to sports radio, and they were talking about him. The guy, I mean, apparently his stats are absurd. I wish I had them in front of me, but I did zero prep for this. I think, you know, from that standpoint, I'm almost more excited to watch him than Fields, like an injured Fields this week for sure, just to see how he does. But I also agree, like, I'm fine with the Bears tanking again and just trying to get two of the first, like, three or four picks.
In 2021, in 15 games, Bajent threw for 5,000 yards and 53 touchdowns.
Yeah. That's I mean, you're playing D2, defenses, but he also has D2 wide receivers.
Sure, yeah. That, I was just going to get to that. Like, he's still on a D2 team here. So, yeah. I mean, that's pretty baller. You know. No knock at D2. Like, there's some good D2 teams.
Obviously. Yeah, there's some good players. I mean, you just don't see many guys coming in. Like, I don't know. But I've heard his stat line's just incredible.
Holds the NCAA record for all-time touchdown passes, 159. It's a D2 record holder for all-time passing yards at 17,034.
17,000?
17,034 in 4 years and 171 touchdowns.
Yeah. I mean, just like absurd stat line. So it's like, yeah, cool. Give the guy a shot, man. Why not? He's earned it. Like, the guy tried really hard.
He beat out PJ Walker. They cut PJ Walker to get this guy elevated, and Nathan Biederman.
Yeah, game winner.
right? Like
PJ Peter Walker has won as many games as Fields. Justin Fields has in like the last year or so.
Yeah, certainly has. I actually thought PJ Walker, like on paper, felt like a good compliment to Fields, but you know, you just stop screwing around at this point, right? Just like see what you have in Badgett, try to trade off.
Apparently, he just straight up won the job. So, I mean, that's what the coaching staff said. They're excited about him.
Good.
Looked good preseason.
None of these bozos are gonna, yeah. None of these bozos are gonna be here next year. So, like, don't let them make the call. Just let this guy go in, tank the record. Yeah. Let's go. Let's get KO.
I think the Vegas matchup, like, I would say, like, the Bears fan is like, yeah, we got a chance. But I thought that for half the games that we played this year. And I'm an idiot. So
yeah.
I still think they have a chance, but I'm, like I said right before, I'm an idiot. So
do you remember I gave you the line at the beginning of the year over under 6.5 of the Bears and you were over? I think you were at 9 wins.
I think I said under, but then I bet on them to win the conference is what happened.
I don't know how you do that at 6.5, but okay.
I said under, but I bet on them to win the conference because I faded myself, and it didn't work.
Everybody I talked to preseason, or you know, was like, you go through this up and down the schedule and you're like, we were thinking we were going to split every game in the division pretty much. We're like, oh, well, you know, I think we'll beat the Packers twice. They're like, oh, at worst, we'll split that. So like the Lions will beat once. They'll always find a way in a Lion. And like, I never thought the Vikings would be this bad. So I thought we would lose 2 to them, but like,
yeah, I had with the Packers because they, you know, with Love coming in, and I don't think Love looked good previously. He had the best game of his career against the Bears week 1. So I'm sure he'll have the second best game of his career week 17 against the Bears. But
right. We'll see. Time will tell. All right, man. It's a wrap. Thanks for coming. I appreciate it.
Yeah. Talk to you later.
Yeah. I've good luck this week.
I'm going to lose by 40. So
you never actually said,
oh, my projection is you will win by 40 points and Tyreek Hill will score those 40 points.
Fantasy Pros has our line at 144.8 to 114.7 in favor.
Yeah.
If I
score over 100 points, I'll be pretty, pretty jazzed. So,
yeah. Well, I'm also past a lot of buy. I actually got to look now that the trade has been made to see like where my buys are back of it. Yeah. We're cooking on all cylinders here.
Yeah.
We're firing on all cylinders.
No, it's a good week to play me with my running backs not playing football. They're not very good anyway, but to then drop down to my second string running backs is, yeah. So
actually, I hope we do get Roshan this week. I know that's not going to be great for me if he plays well, but like as a Bears fan, I want to see Roshan do well.
I want to see him play. I want to see him play. He looks like a good running back. So
yeah. And we're going to have him regardless moving forward. Like we don't have Fields, but we're going to have Roshan. I don't see him going anywhere soon. So
yeah.
I hope that works out. So, all right, man. Anyway, thanks for joining. Good luck on your matchups this week, everybody.
Yep.